Welcome to another episode of Writer and His Politics. Today we have with us an activist from Jharkhand and now a writer on tribal affairs, Mr. Gladson Dungdung. His book, Whose Country Is It Anyways? Untold Stories of Indigenous People of India, is being released tomorrow at the World Book Fair in Delhi. Mr. Gladson, to begin with, if you could tell us, what made you write this book?
What I want to tell through this book is that this country actually, if you see historically, belong to the indigenous people of India.
Okay.
But over the period of time, let's say since Aryan invasion, then British rule, and after independence, and especially if I say Jharkhand, as it was just formed 12 years back. So during this period, you will see that every time indigenous peoples, the Adivasis, they are being discriminated, they are alienated from resources, they are displaced from their land, and everything has been looted in the name of growth and development. But out of this, they got nothing.
Okay.
So the clear message I want to give is enough. We are not saying that since this country belongs to the indigenous people of India, and if you see the judgment of the Supreme Court of India, 5th of January 2011, the Supreme Court of India has clearly said that this country belongs to indigenous people of India, and 92% of the people are the descendant of the invaders.
Okay.
But we are telling that's fine. We are not saying that rest of the people should leave this country. But what I want to say is that let's live. Let us live, and you also live.
Hmm.
You stop, enough is enough. You stop alienating us from the resources.
Hmm.
Stop us from displacing from our land and territory. And also stop discriminating us on the basis of race and caste, and whatever, any kind of discrimination in this country should be stopped.
Okay.
Because constitution of this country also doesn't allow.
Okay. So Gladsonji, tell us, you did mention that at the end of the day, it's also the reason that the tribals in this country have been victimized or sort of marginalized has been primarily the fight over resources. But one of the major issues, perhaps, in any developing part of the world, is that you can't develop without resources. Fortunately or unfortunately, the indigenous people in this country are based in places which have huge resources. Jharkhand, the state that you belong to, have huge amount of coal. We even had people like Mr. Lakshmi Nivas Mittal wanting to open a steel plant there, and of course wanted to mine. How does one balance between development, because we know development can't happen until unless we use our available resources, as well as sort of ensuring proper prosperity and proper rights of our indigenous people?
I think the very definition of development, that is itself wrong, which is defined by the so-called mainstream people of the society. Because development today, what we say is a corporate grab. For example, Mittal. Mittal, he wants 25,000 acres of land. But actually, if you see the utilization of land, really, does he need that much of land for one integrated steel plant? Not at all. Because the history says, let's say HEC, Heavy Engineering Corporation, Ranchi, less than 50% land they could able to utilize for the plant.
Okay.
So corporate has been, taking our resources, huge amount of resources, in the name of, growth and development. And what about the indigenous people? What about the Adivasis?
Hmm.
Like, development that should go, for everybody. That is inclusive growth and development.
But could you define and elaborate a little bit when you understand, what do you understand by inclusive growth? Because one of the major complaints that's always been is that writers like you or magazines like ours always keep on writing about tribal rights, but we never give a solution. We only point towards a problem. what do you mean by inclusive growth? How do you think, let's say if a Mittal or a SR wants to set up a mining company in Jharkhand, how do you, or what are the positive steps or suggestions that you would give to this company? Because the fact is that mining will happen whether you like it or not. How do you ensure that the tribals get the equal right? Which are some sort of positive suggestions that you would like to give?
We have personally, myself also, I have never opposed development is going on. But what I am telling is, see, for example, in Saranda. Saranda, 25% of iron ore is lying there.
Yeah.
But at the same time, if you see the Adivasis, in which condition they live, they don't have health centers, don't have education facility, they don't even have the drinking water and so on. But at the same time, the people who, went there from the outside, they are enjoying everything. They have best education system, they have, health system, everything. They have big houses, vehicle, whatnot. Then question is, why this is happening?
Okay.
It is only happening because state is not bothered about the indigenous people. You have the, very good constitution, which have a special provision in the, of the fifth schedule, which says that indigenous people should enjoy their, rights in their territory, especially in the fifth schedule area, land, territory and resources. Similarly, we have the best laws, safeguard, like Chotanagpur Land Tenancy Act, Santal Pargana Land Tenancy Act, which, prohibits the land alienation. Despite having the, very progressive law, why every day the land has been taken away legally or illegally? That question needs to be addressed.
So that's interesting. I mean, we are talking at a time when Narendra Modi just has given this huge, delivered a huge lecture at Delhi University's college SRCC, in which he is again speaking about development and all those things. And here you are saying that when it comes to basic development, it almost seems as if the state is intentionally ignoring the indigenous people. I mean, when you have people coming from outside, they get all the facilities, but the people who have been living in, on the same land for years, they don't have the basic sort of requirements. So do you really mean that the state is actually intentionally ignoring the indigenous people in spite of having the best of laws?
Definitely, it is, ignorance is basis on the race.
Okay.
Because right from the beginning, we have been seeing. For example, let's take the example. You'll find in my book also that rape case took place. That horrible rape case, everybody will condemn, and I also do same. But after the Delhi rape case, you see that 11 girls were raped in the Chhattisgarh. That is also in the government school. That is residential school.
Yes.
But what was the reaction of the whole community in Delhi? People didn't come up. Sonia Gandhi, she cried for this Delhi rape case. But what was her reaction about Chhattisgarh tribal girl? It shows that nobody cares about the Adivasi. They just see that Adivasi, even today, they want to see them as subhuman, jungly, uncivilized, and so on. They don't want to come out of that frame.
But what about JMM? I mean, it did come to power.
See, JMM was never in majority. They run the government with the support of the Congress and other RJD and small other parties. So therefore, every time either they were influenced or controlled by Sonia Gandhi or Lalu Prasad Yadav. So see, unless you give them, free chance to take decision, things will not move.
One of the very interesting points in your book is the concept of communalization, and you actually have a chapter which is called Sowing Seeds of Hatred in Adivasi Land. Interestingly, I have grown up in Jharkhand myself. We know that there was never a communal discord or disharmony among tribals. And why do you suggest this? I mean, do you mean that the people, the non-tribals, have actually inserted this concept of communalization within the tribal people? And may I also point out that Jharkhand has a huge presence of Catholic missionaries?
See here, this is the main thing, like a right wing Hindutva forces. They were always afraid of the identity, like Adivasi. That means indigenous people of this country. So they used to call them one Vasi. So that was put up. They know that the people of Jharkhand, because Jharkhand is a land of historical struggle. So any day they can challenge that this country belongs to them. Therefore, they, you know, categorically they put this and create a division so that Adivasi always fight among them, and then main issues is lost in between. That is the whole practices. Therefore, every time RSS has a huge interest in Jharkhand, and every time they are, you know, creating this kind of hatred politics there.
Gladson ji, no discussion on tribals are complete without speaking on Naxalism. I mean, Jharkhand, we see a very unusual phenomena when it comes to the Maoists. Just like in the mainstream where we have seen 8 chief minister in 12 years, even the Naxal movement in Jharkhand seems to be quite different than the other states. I mean, in Chhattisgarh and Orissa, Bihar also to an extent, and Bengal, we have seen it much more disciplined. Well, Jharkhand seems to be free for all. People are killing each other. There are a number of splinter groups. Tell us a bit about why does even the Jharkhand Maoist politics seem to be different than other parts of the country?
In Jharkhand, this Naxalism came through this feudalism, especially in Plamu region. There was, you know, Dalit, because Dalit, they don't have lands. So this landlord, they used to exploit them. So this Dalit people first joined the Naxal movement. And then later stage, when there were huge land alienation illegally and also for the development projects, then perhaps Adivasi youth, they decided that they won't be able to save their land with this so-called democratic struggle, because state is every time determined to take away their resources. So they perhaps convinced that they will only be able to protect their resources if they take up the gun. So that was the thing, because so many places I visited, I talked to the people, I said, why you joined the Naxal movement? So answer is the same. So many people say that.
No, but I understand. I'm sorry, I'm interrupting you. That seems to be the story across this country. But what I'm asking is that why does it land up having so many splinter groups? What is the reason why Jharkhand, even the Maoist party, doesn't seem to be a strong one in terms of, you know, having everybody under one? I mean, you have, you know, different splinter groups happening, and everybody, and even we have heard stories of extortion, and it's almost like a criminal gang. There's nothing politics about it. So what leads to a such situation in Jharkhand?
Yeah, I am coming to that. One thing is definitely, because in between, I think you must have heard that in Naxal movement also, there was huge problem in terms of leadership.
Okay.
So Adivasis inside, they started questioning, why we are only the, you know, the fighter people? Why should not we also take up leadership?
Okay.
So there was crisis, and then in between Lucas Tete was killed. That was the huge problem. And again, before that also, similarly, sometimes when, you know, in 2004, that MCC and the People's War Group, when they merged, so especially this Ganju group, that is a Dalit group, they were not, ready to merge. So they decided they will go out. And then similarly, so many people, even in Bundu, some people told me that they joined the Maoists because they like their ideology, but later on they saw that there is gap in the ideology. So they came out of that group, and they created a splinter group. And at the same time, let me also tell you that police also created so many splinter groups. For example, in Latehar and Plamu region, you will see the Tritiya Prastuti
Committee
group, or Jharkhand Tritiya Prastuti group. Similarly, in Khunti region, JLT, and then which later on became PLFI, People's Liberation Movement of India. So many people, and this was officially accepted by the police that definitely they use a couple of group to fight the Maoist. Therefore, so many times I questions. On the one hand, the Prime Minister of India says that the growth of extremism is the biggest security threat to the India. But on the other hand, the same police forces, they use the other group. So no, whether these are the so this is, I think, why they select, you know, selective action is also one of the reason for growth of the
extremism. I accept your argument, but for argument's sake, I would also want to know that are you then suggesting that the only splinter groups or the Maoist groups who are extorting are the ones that have been floated with the police? Are you suggesting that the ones that have already had a political difference and the split from the party, they don't extort?
What I understand is so many groups, basically some groups are created with the clear vision to take some extortion money. Because once you have gun, so you can do any kind of things. Okay, so many people are doing like this, and in between Maoist group also, so many people were practicing that, and then they came to know that some people are doing bad practices, so they were kicked out, and again they form a small group and they are doing that, and because of this kind of splinter group, some region like Khuti became a clearly killing field. So many so innocent people are being killed. That is really shock. And then I don't see state police taking proactive role or the CRPF, because they only care about the Maoist. They want to fight only against the Maoist, but they don't care about this splinter group. That is also region. Because so many, if you move, you will find people are with a gun and police is going, but nobody bothers.
Let me end this discussion or rather chat by asking you about the larger debate that's has been raging in this country for the last few years on Maoism and tribals. A lot of people sort of try to make both the same, but they also point out that one of the reasons that the Maoism has sort of festered and grown in tribal areas is primarily because of lack of development, how the state has over the years neglected development in this region. To ask you, as a tribal, as a prominent tribal activist from Jharkhand, let me ask you a simple question. How does one, if you were Prime Minister of India calls you tomorrow and says, Mr. Gladson, Dungdung, tell me how do we end Naxalism in Jharkhand, what will be your suggestion?
See, I have questioned so many times, with this kind of national debate in national television channel or maybe in the other media, that they say that the conclusion of the debate is the growth of Naxalism is only for two reasons. One is that Adivasis are poor, and second, development didn't reach to them. But of course, these are some of reason. But the basic reason is denial of justice. That's why even I had written, when Mr. P. Chidambaram was the Home Minister, I had written that these issues would not come to an end unless you deal the issue of injustice.
So it's not development, but it is injustice.
Yeah, injustice. For example,
So Mr. Narendra Modi is delivering a lecture at this moment and SRCC hears this. It's not development, but justice, that's what you're speaking about. Justice for 2002 perhaps as well.
Yeah, definitely. What I understand is so many people say that, my land has been taken away by the powerful person. I went to the police station, nobody here. I went to that station, nobody here. But I went to the Maoist, they came on the night, and then my land was freed. I got the land. So even today, if you see now more than 65 years of glorious Indian democracy, but common man is not able to file FIR in the police station. So you can understand.
Forget about tribals, not even ordinary men.
Exactly. Therefore, I am saying that if Indian state really bothered about the Maoism, or really they are concerned to address this issue, they should go to door, hear the Adivasis, ask them that we are with you, come, you join the democracy, we are ready to hear, address issue to the door to door. See, things will be changed. There will be no place for Naxalism. Then you don't have to put your CRPF then other forces in the forest. But there will be no Naxalism if Indian state is determined to address the issue of injustice, or let's say issue of justice and human rights.
So thank you, Mr. Dungdung. So it's very clearly it's about justice, less perhaps on development. So thanks a lot for talking to us, Mr. Dungdung. And next week again, we'll meet one of a writer and perhaps discuss his politics. Thank you for listening.